Hey guys, it's Brady. I hope you guys are having fun hanging out with your families and at your homes. I'm going to read a passage from the Bible to you, and it's going to be about when Judas agrees to betray Jesus and then about the Last Supper. So it's going to be from Luke chapter 22, verse 1 through 23. So the festival of unleavened bread, which is also called Passover, was approaching. The leading priests and teachers of religious law were plotting how to kill Jesus, but they were afraid of people's reaction. Then Satan entered into Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12 disciples, and he went to the leading priests and captains of the temple guard to discuss the best way to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted, and they promised to give him money. So he agreed and began looking for an opportunity to betray Jesus so they could arrest him when the crowds weren't around. Now the festival of unleavened bread arrived when the Passover lamb is sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John ahead and said, "Go and prepare the Passover meal so we can eat it together." "Where do you want us to prepare it?" they asked him. He replied, "As soon as you enter Jerusalem, a man carrying a pitcher of water will meet you. Follow him. At the house he enters, say to the owner, 'The teacher asks, where's the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?' He will take you upstairs to a large room that is already set up. That is where you should enter, or that is where you should prepare our meal." They went off to the city and found everything just as Jesus had said, and they prepared the Passover meal there. When the time came, Jesus and the apostles sat down together at the table. Jesus said, "I have been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you now that I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. Then he said, "Take this and share it among yourselves, for I will not drink wine again until the kingdom of God has come." He took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it into pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took another cup of wine and said, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. But here at this table, sitting among us as a friend, is a man who will betray me. For it has been determined that the Son of Man must die. But what sorrow awaits the one who betrays him?" The disciples began to ask each other which of them would ever do such a thing. And that's the passage.
Okay, so we just read this story, and it's about the Last Supper. And it's kicking off our series that's leading up to Easter. So some important things we want to learn from this story. First of all, it is a very important story because it tells us a lot of the reasons behind what Jesus did. Why did he go to the cross? Why did he do what he did? Why did he raise from the dead? And this story really helps us understand that all. So there's this festival or this feast that they have, right, which is called Passover. This is going way back to when they were in Israel, or when the Israelites were in Egypt. And when God freed the Israelites from the Egyptians by killing all of the firstborn of the Egyptians. It was one of the plagues, right? God brought 10 plagues. The 10th one was the worst. He told the Egyptians, "Hey, if you don't want this to happen to you, you need to do certain things." And they said, "Whatever, we don't listen to that." But the Israelites listened. They said, God said that they should put blood over the top of their door, in a special way, and God would see that blood, would see that something had died in somebody else's place. The lamb that gave the blood had died in the place of the person that would die instead. And so then this angel of death, as it's called, would pass over the house. Like, there's a little house, and then they put blood on the top, the blood of a lamb, and then the angel of death would see the blood and then keep going. because the angel would know, okay, something has died in the place of the person that they were going to kill. And so all the Israelites did that and had their kids, their firstborn, saved, whereas the Egyptians did not do that and their firstborn died. So it's actually really symbolic because Jesus is going to now become that Passover lamb. He's going to become that blood that covers over us so that we don't have to die for our sins. Instead, Jesus is dying for our sins. So it's actually really important that this is happening this way. So, anyways, the Israelites have been celebrating this festival. They've been celebrating all this time. Now, Jesus is going to give it new meaning. So, first of all, we learn that Judas agrees to betray Jesus. So, Satan entered into Judas, who was one of the 12 disciples. This was always God's plan that Judas would not be a true disciple, would not be faithful to the end, and that Satan would be able to use him to do this horrible thing. So we get to the actual celebration. They go up into a special room and they're eating the Passover meal, which is normally how they celebrate. But then Jesus starts to give it new meaning. He says in verse 15, Jesus said, "I have been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you now that I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Okay, he's giving it new meaning. Here he goes. Verse 17, "Then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. Then he said, 'Take this and share it among yourselves, for I will not drink wine again till the kingdom of God has come.' He took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' After supper, he took another cup of wine and said, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you.'" So really important right there. He's saying everything that needs to be said. At this festival, they normally drink some wine and eat some meat and bread, and that's how they celebrate. And then he says, "Here's this cup of wine. I'm giving it new meaning. It's going to be a new covenant." And a covenant is like an agreement or a promise. And in the Old Testament, back when the Israelites first came out of Egypt, God gave them a covenant. He said, "You can be my people, I will be your God, follow my rules, and I will bless you and protect you." It was pretty simple like that. And now he's saying, that didn't work because you guys couldn't keep your end of the bargain. So I'm giving you a new covenant. In this covenant, I will be a sacrifice for you. So right there, look at it again. This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. Sometimes in the Bible, the word cup is used to talk about not just like a actual cup, but also to talk about like a something that somebody's gonna get. So like in the Old Testament, there's a verse where it talks about the cup of God's wrath is poured out, right? So it's like there's this cup full of God's anger against sin. It's gonna be poured out onto sinners, right? And they're going to be destroyed because we can't stand up to God because of our sin. And so now Jesus is saying this cup is actually, this cup of God's wrath, this cup of anger against sin is actually filled with my blood. And that will pay for your sin. So when he says this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, he's saying the agreement is, I will pour out my blood as a sacrifice for you, and that will cover your sin. That will fill up this cup of anger, and then you won't need to be punished for your sins anymore. Which is a pretty crazy thing. And that's why we celebrate communion. If you go in church, you see we will, break the bread and pass it around, and then we have the little cups of grape juice. They're symbols because they're talking about this exact thing. What used to be a Passover celebration for 3,000, 4,000 years, whatever, a lot of time, has now become our communion celebration, where we remember what Jesus did for us in giving us his new covenant. So yeah, check out the video and enjoy.